So Hare Krishna, everyone.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you very much for coming and being with us. We very much like to wish and welcome our very special guest, His Holiness Jai Advaita Swami. So we're very happy to have Jai Advaita Maharaj back here at Soho Street again. Tonight he will be giving a presentation on how Srila Prabhupada's books came to be. So we'd like to welcome Maharaj by chanting very loudly, three Hari Bol.
Hari Bol! Hari Bol! Hari Bol!
I could also ask everyone to please move as far forward as possible, and if anyone else comes, they've got room to sit. Thank you, Hare Krishna.
Namaste Saraswati Deva, Gauravani Pujaya, Yudhishesha Shunyavadi, Astitadesha Bhavi. Well, this evening we'll have something of an in-house presentation. The topics will mostly be of interest to those who are seriously involved in the Hare Krishna movement, but others may also find it interesting in terms of how things get published and how things get republished. So we'll speak this evening about the publishing of Srila Prabhupada's books. I gave a long class at the Manor about all the things that went into printing Prabhupada's books, but that's that requires us another day, which we're not going to invest this time. So this will be the second class, which concerns the editing of Srila Prabhupada's books and especially the revision of Srila Prabhupada's books. Before I start, there's one item I'd like to bring to your attention. And this is a letter from Srila Prabhupada, which is which is relevant in some ways, and in any case ought to be common knowledge. Yes, this is time for the phones to go biddy by. So anyone who has a cell phone, you can give it a check and let it rest peacefully. This is a letter dated March 14th, 1974. It's a memorandum from Srila Prabhupada to all ISKCON centers. My dear disciples, please accept my blessings. Now that our ISKCON is growing into a huge worldwide organization, it has come to my attention that sometimes centers are printing my literature, taking collection, and spending all outside the jurisdiction of the Bhaktivedanta Book Trust. This must not go on. I specifically formed the BBT to invest in it exclusive rights for the printing of all literature containing my teachings, writings, and lectures. In this way, the collections are to be divided 50% for printing new books and 50% for construction of temples. The BBT can authorize a center to print, as in the case of foreign translations, with the agreement that when the foreign printing becomes financially solvent, they will pay royalties to the BBT. But all printing of ISKCON literature must be by the BBT or under their sanction and approval. If temples print independently, it will be at the cost of the books I am myself printing, and could eventually cause the financial ruin of the BBT, meaning I could not order new books from the printer or have sufficient funds for construction of temple projects. I trust this is now clear, and you will all do the needful. If you have any questions in this matter, you can write me directly or consult with the GBC representative. Your well-wisher, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami. So that's a very clear instruction that Prabhupada wanted all of his books to be published exclusively by the BBT. Because of a legal difficulty in which one of the past trustees had not been properly removed from the board and was claiming to be the only trustee, and because he had some technical grounds on which he had some standing, the BBT was obliged to give a license to a second organization which has some scope for publishing some of Srila Prabhupada's books. But you can see here that that's not what Prabhupada wanted, and anyone who's involved in purchasing books from such a source can think about this letter. Or anyone who's, yeah, okay. Any questions about that? Clear enough. Abundantly clear. This is a site concerning the editing of Srila Prabhupada's books. As everything we'll talk about this evening, and a lot more, as videos and samples of Prabhupada's manuscripts, lots of stuff here, bbtedit.com. You can go there and find lots of stuff. Now, by the way, if you have some Bhagavad Gitas here, you might want to take a look at them.
I don't think you have any first editions here. That'd be cool also to see what I'm talking about.
But you can distribute those, the second editions, just so people can sort of see what we're talking about. Explain to you what we're going to do. I'll explain to you generally what we're going to do. I'll explain a little bit. I'll play you this a sound clip first of Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada dictated the introduction to Bhagavad Gita as it is in 1966, and we have a recording of that dictation at the Bhaktivedanta Archives, and it's also, I think, been released for general interest. And there he speaks the entire introduction, which of course was later edited by the original editor of Bhagavad Gita as it is, Radha-Krishna Prabhu. And this is the only part for which there's dictation. The chapters, first six chapters, Prabhupada typed himself. And after that, he received a dictating machine, which he used for the rest of the book and for his subsequent books. So there's no. Is that the next door neighbors or something? What's coming through? So the only audio we have is this introduction, and it's very instructive to listen to this audio. These are the concluding words from the introduction. What you'll see on the screen is the text published in the first edition of Bhagavad Gita, as it is. Now I should explain. First edition was published in 1972, first by the Macmillan Company, and then later by the Bhaktivedanta Book Trust. In 1983, we published a revised edition with the aim of correcting various errors, bringing the text closer to Srila Prabhupada's original words, and restoring various, restoring sections of material that had been lost, that had not been included in the first edition. The PBT trustees requested me to do that work, which I did, and it was later reviewed by the ISKCON Governing Body Commission, and an opportunity was given for input from all the devotees. We sent out a big package to inform all the leaders in the ISKCON English-speaking world what corrections were being proposed for the translations and what else was being done. And then, with the approval of the GBC, we published the second edition in 1983, which is the edition that we have here, and which has been passed around. Okay. And you can, to keep me honest here and to sort of be informative for the other devotees, those who have these books, you can follow along and see, you know, sort of compare it to what you're hearing. Okay? Now, aloha. On which screen was the audio played? Disappeared. Let's see what's happening. Getting sound, guys. What's happening?
He also gets angry, said, then what to speak of Bhagavad Gita? Bhagavad Gita is the next.
Do you know what that is?
In the
that's the one that I couldn't find.
And spoken by Vishnu.
Radha-Krishna
is the original Vishnu. Vishnu Bhakta Dinasadam. It is coming out of the mouth of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And the moon of Ganges is said to be emanated from the lotus feet of the Lord. And Bhagavad Gita is emanated from the mouth of the
The problem is that I'm on smaller screens.
There is no difference between the mouth and the feet and the Supreme Lord. From neutral position, we can study that Bhagavad Gita is more important than the Ganges water. Sarvo Kamasuro Gava.
The other one's playing? Okay.
which one should therefore the conclusion is that Bhagavad Gita is a transcendental literature which one should read very carefully. Gita Sahasramidam Punyam Jappathet Prajata Pumah. And the result will be properly follows the instruction, then he can be freed from all miseries of life, all anxieties of life, bhayasokadi vibhajjita, all fears of life in this life, as well as he will get a spiritual life in the next life. Gita-dhyana-sīlasya pranāyāma-parasya-ca naiva-santi-pāpāni-pūdva-janam-kṛtāni-ca. Another advantage is that if one reads Bhagavad-gītā very sincerely and with all seriousness, then by the grace of the Lord, the reactions of his past misdeeds will not act upon him. The Lord says very loudly in the Bhagavad Gita, in the last portion, Aham tam sarupapi pa mokhoishyami mahuja. The Lord takes the responsibility. One who surrenders unto the Lord, he takes the responsibility to indemnify from all reactions of sins. Malaninmochanam punsham jalasnanadi dinedine, jalasnanam dinedine sakrit gita mushisnanam samsaram malam nasanam. One cleanses oneself daily by taking bath in the water, but one who takes one's bath in the sacred Ganges water of Bhagavad Gita is the dirty material life is altogether vanquished. Gita Sugita Kartavya Kimanvayin Sastra Vistarai Ya Sayam Padmanavasya Mukha Padma Dinistrita. Because Bhagavad Gita is spoken by the Supreme Personality of God, therefore, people may not read all other Vedic literature simply if they attentively and regularly reads and hears Bhagavad Gita, Gita, Sugita, Kartavya, and one should adopt these means, by all means, Gita, Sugita, Kartavya, Kimannai, Shastra Vistrayi. Because at the present age, people are embarrassed with so many things that it is hardly possible to divert their attention in all the Vedic literature. This one literature will do, because it is the essence of all Vedic literature, and especially spoken by the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Bhārataṁ mita-sarvasyam viṣṇu bhaktyād vinishtitam gītā-gaṅgodakam vidvā unajjanma nariddhate. As it is said that one who drinks the water of the Ganges, he also gets salvation then what to speak of Bhagavad Gita? Bhagavad Gita is the nectar in the whole Mahabharata and is spoken by Vishnu. Radha-Krishna is the original Vishnu. Vishnu Bhakta Dhanisita. It is coming out of the mouth of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And Gangodakam, Ganges, is said to be emanated from the lotus feet of the Lord. And Bhagavad Gita is emanated from the mouth of the Lord. Of course, there is no difference between the mouth and the feet of the Supreme Lord. Still, from neutral position, we can study that Bhagavad Gita is even more important than the Ganges water. Sarvopanishudo gava dugdha upala nandana partha vasa sudhir bhakta dugdham gita mrutam maha. This Gita Upanishad is just like a cow, and the Lord is famous as cow boy, and he was milking this cow, Sarva Upanishad. And it is the essence of all Upanishads and represented as the cow, and the Lord being expert cow dog, he is milking the cow. And Parthavasa, and Arjuna is just like the calf, and Sudhir Bhokta, and learned scholars, and pure devotees, they are to take this milk. Sudhir Bhokta Durtham Gita Amritamaha. The nectar, the milk of Bhagavad Gita, is meant for learned devotees. Evam Shastram Devaki Putra Gitam Eka Deva Devaki Putra Eva Eka Mantrastasya Navani Yani Karma Karmapi Egam Tasya Devasya Seva. Now, the world should learn from the Bhagavad Gita the lesson. Evam Shastram Devaki Putra Gita. There is one scripture only, one common scripture for the whole world, for the people of the whole world, and that is this Bhagavad Gita. Deva Devaki Putra Eva. And there is one God but the whole world is Sri Krishna. And Eka Mantrastasya Navani, and but one hymn, mantra, one hymn only, one prayer, or one hymn is to chant his name. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama. Eka mantrastasya navani jani karmapi ekam tasya devasya siva. And there is one work only, that is to serve the Supreme Personality of God. If one learns from Bhagavad Gita that the people are very much anxious to have one religion, one God, one scripture, and one business, or one activity of life. This is summarized in the Bhagavad Gita, that one God is Krishna. Krishna is not sectarian God. Krishna, from from the name of Krishna, Krishna means, as we have explained above, Krishna means the greatest name. So therefore...
That's the end of the tape. So, what did you notice? There's some interesting features here in the, as we compare the words of the first edition to the recording. What would you say is the most conspicuous feature? Yeah, all the Sanskrit verses, or practically all the Sanskrit verses, have been left out. Srila Prabhupada is quoting from the Gita Mahatmya, 8 verses, I believe. And he quotes the Sanskrit for each one, and they've all been omitted. Apparently what happened was that back in those days, no one knew those verses. And so they had, you know, nothing to do except to puzzle over them, and or to take the expedient route of deleting them. So that's what they did. But there's one instance where they gave it a good try, and that's right up front. It's capable of saving one from all fear. Neha bikrama nasho sti pratyabhayo nividyate. Svalpamapyasya dharmasya trayate mahato payat. Do you remember Prabhupada speaking that verse? No. But here it is, the Sanskrit verse along with its translation. And here's my educated guess about how it got there. Prabhupada's quoting from Gita Mahatmya, Payashoka Vivarjita. And the devotees were unfamiliar with that verse, but there was a word that they recognized, Paya. And they remembered a verse, Trayate Mahato Payat. So they put in the verse they knew, added the translation, and there you have it. So the verses that Prabhupada quoted were left out, but this one that he didn't quote goes in. There are some other small things. Do you remember Krishna proclaiming very loudly? But that's not there. Is it there in the second edition? Before Sarva Dharma and Pratyaja? Sarvadharman Pratyaja, you found that place? What before that, what did it say?
The Lord says very loudly.
The Lord says very loudly. Okay, so in the second edition he says it loudly. And are all those Sanskrit verses there in the second edition? The ones that you were hearing as Prabhupada was speaking, were they all there?
Yes.
They're there, okay. And there are some other interesting things, like you might have heard where Prabhupada said from a neutral position, which is in our position here, in the second edition, it's great. So you get the idea. There were various things that were skipped or left out or in one case put in. And this is fairly typical of the problems that the original editors had back in the 1966-67 time when they were brand new to Krishna consciousness, really, and they were had no Sanskrit editor to run to, and nor were they familiar with the verses or the Sanskrit, or even more than the very basics of the philosophy. So they did really a great job with editing the book, all things considered. It's not easy, but there were mistakes, and so that's what the second edition seeks to rectify. Now, I'm going to give you a taste here of, well, first I'll show you what the original manuscripts were. For the first 6 chapters, as I mentioned, Srila Prabhupada typed them himself with 2 fingers. And if this were a little smaller, or bigger, Prabhupada typed this himself, and you can see when I get back up there that all the Sanskrit is in place, the word for word meanings are in place, things are basically quite tidy and orderly. And then Prabhupada starts using the dictaphone, and this is what it's like. You can see the Sanskrit from the word for word is left out, and there's a lot of a lot left out. When Kay was present, there were only a few number of persons who could understand him, that he is the SPG. Even in the assembly of blank, when blank spoke against Kay being elected to the president of the assembly, blank supported him that he is SPG. Similarly, blankety blank of the Pandava and a few others knew he was the SUPG, but not others. You could see they were struggling, and sometimes they couldn't hear what Prabhupada was saying, or sometimes they'd fill it in with what they thought it said. Sometimes they'd be right, and sometimes wrong. That's the middle six chapters. This is what we have. The last six chapters, somehow these manuscripts, these transcriptions were lost. By the time I went back to edit them, or to edit the book, I expected to find them, and they were missing. And all we had was a retyping of them, which I had done myself in 1968 as one of the first projects assigned to me. So those manuscripts look like this. So in this manuscript, you get a little bit more of what was originally there, but not everything, because I didn't reproduce all the mistakes when I retyped. I followed a lot of the editing that had already been done, which is why there were fewer revisions made in the last six chapters, because we didn't have the stuff to go by. Any questions so far? Yes?
Let's see what this is. This is the abridged Bhagavad Gita as it is, which was first published by Macmillan and then published by
the DVT.
It's quite a rare thing these days.
You came to Krishna consciousness with this book. Marvelous. Yeah, this is pretty much. This is different from both of them. Before we published the first unabridged edition in 1972, Macmillan Company had published an abridged edition. And this is it, in which there was no Sanskrit, no word-for-word meaning, and the purports were way cut down to meet the publisher's needs at the time. But later, as Prabhupada writes in the preface to Bhagavad Gita, as it is, the book was selling well, and the publisher said, okay, let's go for the unabridged. So that was the 1972 edition. So there have been a few different editions. Prabhupada wrote, he wasn't very happy with this because so much had to be cut. Nice that you have it. Thank you. Anything else? Yes?
Yeah, I noticed, I come from a Christian background.
Uh-huh.
I grew up in a Christian environment.
Uh-huh.
Sorry.
I grew up in a Christian environment,
mm-hmm.
and I learned the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
And I noticed the Bhagavad Gita, there are a lot of similarity, both of them, especially the life of the Krishna and Jesus Christ, there are so many similarities.
Yeah.
So what's your comment about this? Is it the same person, or is it a reincarnation, or what?
Well, I'm going to deal with that very briefly, because I'm sort of very focused on a different topic this evening. But in essence, in the Bible, Jesus Christ claims to be the Son of God. And in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna identifies himself as God. So Jesus is the Son, and Krishna is the Father. Okay. Any other questions here? Okay, so now you know a little bit about what the manuscripts were that we were working from. And now I can take you to the next piece of stuff. This is a movie, or this takes you through a movie made by Yadubara Prabhu, our cinematographer, of Srila Prabhupada translating a verse from Srimad Bhagavatam. And it's been put together with the dictaphone tapes of the same portion that were given to the transcribers. So it gives you, it will give you some idea of what Srila Prabhupada said and what the transcribers heard.
Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur gives in this connection a description of the difference of the Supreme Personality of Godhead and ordinary living being. So this is in the previous verse, Sarvam Pumana Veda Gunansu Tadgyam Naveda Sarvagam Manantamire. The purpose is that Supreme Lord, He is omnipotent, omniscient, He knows everything, but the living being does not know actually what is the position of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. That is the difference between the Supreme Personality of Godhead and ordinary living being.
Thanks for giving to the transcribers.
And so the Supreme Personality of Godhead, ordinary living being. And so the Supreme Personality of Godhead, ordinary living being. Difference of the Supreme Personality of Godhead and ordinary living being.
Okay. Easy job to be a transcriber, right? Apart from Srila Prabhupada's accent, which sometimes made it difficult to understand what he was saying. He's stopping and starting on that dictating machine, and sometimes a word is being cut off at the beginning, sometimes cut off at the end, and it made it a tough job. And so, understandably, the devotees sometimes had difficulty getting it right. Now I'm going to show you some of the typical revisions that we made for Bhagavad Gita for the second edition. This is at the end of chapter 2. I think it may be the last verse. Unfortunately, this is clipped a little bit because of the form factor of the... see if I can do better. See what happens if I go back to the...